Thank you, Yiftach, and thanks everybody for this opportunity to tell you about essentially merging together the two prior talks, Bitcoin and SNARKs. This is joint work with my co-authors, Eli Ben-Sasson from Technion, Alessandro from ETH Zurich and MIT, who you've just heard, Christina Garman, Matt Green, and Ian Myers from Johns Hopkins University, and Madras Virza from MIT. Let's go back to Bitcoin. I'll start off a bit redundant with Stefan's talk, but we'll soon deviate into a particular problem. Bitcoin is a decentralized digital currency, and digital means that coins are represented as knowledge of some bit strings. If I know some number, I can treat it as a unit of value to pay someone else and get various goods. Now, the problem with numbers is that if you can send them once, then you can send them multiple times, creating a double spending attack. And that, of course, would devalue the currency. So the way this is tackled and prevented in Bitcoin is using the public ledger or bulletin board, or in Bitcoin terminology, the blockchain, which records every transaction. Every time there's a payment made, there's a recording of who pays whom and how much. Because every new transaction is appended, they cannot be duplicated. A merchant accepting a payment will make sure that it's not a duplicate payment that already appears in the blockchain. Of course, there are synchronization and consensus issues, as Stefan discussed, but let's abstract them away for this discussion and assume a perfect ledger. The cost of this is privacy, because we really are broadcasting the information about every transaction to everybody on the internet. So if you're a consumer making a payment, then anyone out there can observe who you paid, when, and how much. This can be embarrassing. It's like posting your credit card statements in real time on the internet for anyone to see. When you pay a merchant, they can see how much you have left in your wallet, maybe charge you accordingly, maybe signal to someone down a dark alley that maybe you could be relieved of some of those funds. And even those merchants are vulnerable to eavesdropping and monitoring by the competitors, who can now see their cash flow in real time. So there have been claims, there is this folklore that Bitcoin is anonymous or pseudonymous because users can do not immediately identify themselves by their real name, but only by some key. But in reality, most users have one or very few keys or addresses. And there's a lot of research showing that actually the transaction graph can be analyzed and users can be identified. Adi has a number of works showing this repeatedly in very dramatic ways. And clearly, there is no anonymity or even strong pseudonymity here. Another related threat is that of fungibility. The risk that because coin can be tracked back through their history and evolution, people may decide to reject or devalue coins depending on where they come from. So when you go to one store, maybe they won't be willing to accept a coin that you got as change from their competitors. Or maybe there's a rumor that the coin that you got a year ago actually used to belong to a terrorist organization. True or false, it means that people won't assign as much value to your coin, so you really have no idea how much your wallet is worth, and that's the basic destabilization of the economy. If you watched SNBC comics yesterday, you could have seen a concrete proposal for splitting currency into good, evil, and neutral, and this is what could happen to Bitcoin. Clearly, that's not something that you want to happen for a stable currency. And what we have here is a very paradoxical situation in terms of the Bitcoin ideology. Bitcoin set out to solve the centralization problem. We don't want to trust any central banks anymore. We don't want them to track us and control us. But instead of trusting our privacy to a single bank, we ended up just trusting them to everybody, trusting our privacy to everybody and leaking all our information. This won't do. So in the work I'm presenting, we address this problem and present a system called Zero Cash, which provides divisible anonymous payments. And Zero Cash is a new protocol that's that can sit on top of Bitcoin, or can, you can also deploy it as a variant of Bitcoin. Essentially what it does is it takes that blockchain and anonymizes it. There are still transactions in the blockchains, but to an outsider, they look just like a bunch of pseudo-random values. So users can still pay each other, but the value of their transactions, the origin, destination, timing, all are all hidden from outsiders. Now, jumping ahead a bit, let me just convince you that this will be efficient, and you may be doubting this in light of the preceding discussion on SNARKs and their efficiency. So here are some numbers. The proofs that we are going to create are less than 300 bytes long. They take a few milliseconds to verify and under a minute to create. There is some public parameters or system parameters file that you need to create and share with everyone to facilitate the proofs. The same one that Alessandro discussed. It's under a gigabyte in size, which is already much, much smaller than the whole Bitcoin blockchain. So devices dealing with Bitcoin will typically be well equipped to hold a gigabyte of storage.
On the other hand, we don't really need, that's an error in Bitcoin, the fact that you store the whole.
It is indeed an error, and we'll be addressing a potential solution in the final slide. And fortunately, it's a constant file, so it's, there's even though not much issue of communication here.
What is the size of the Bitcoin history account?
24 gigabytes. The parameters are set once and for all to enable the system to operate, then you can continue doing transactions until the heat death of the universe. So this parameter generation is trusted, and that's another point that we'll allude to later, but it's only done once. And of course, there are some cryptographic assumptions, so let's be upfront here. We are using elliptic curve crypto with pairing friendly curves. We are using a knowledge assumption, the knowledge of exponent assumption. Unfortunately, a non-falsifiable one, but apparently an increasingly popular one. It's, variants of these assumptions have been proposed and used for over a decade now and seem heuristically to be on, okay. There are no interesting known attacks, they are very powerful for many applications, including ours. And we'll be using some garden variety hash functions, encryption schemes, signature schemes, for regular ones you would find in standards.
Just to understand something, you say if it's on top of Bitcoin, or it's a separate currency, if it's on top of Bitcoin, then people who have the parameters can transact with each other, but it's regular Bitcoin, so other, everybody else who's using regular Bitcoin will accept the transaction implicitly. What does he mean by on top?
So there are several ways to deploy this, the cryptographic scheme that I'll describe. One is to think about it as something you build separately aside from Bitcoin, and people can redeem their Bitcoins into these new coins that we're using. An alternative way is to integrate it with Bitcoin as one coherent system. If time allows, I'll describe this in more detail. I think it will become evident what's the interesting common part to both proposals as I'll go. So the approach of Zero Cash is to use cryptographic proofs. And let me illustrate this with the following example. We have a sender of a payment, say a consumer, and the recipient of a payment, say a merchant. And I adapted the slides to be consistent with Alessandro's to say that there is a transfer of 42 bitcoins from the sender to the receiver. How can the receiver be convinced that payment is indeed correct? How can the receiver be convinced? Well, the sender is already convinced. The sender knows that he received this payment from someone else in the past. They know that they haven't spent it so far. They know that they checked the incoming transaction when it was conducted. So on this side, there's all the requisite information. And we can say, wait, maybe just send it over for the receiver to check. But that would be a slight issue with privacy, right? We don't want to reveal our past transactions just in order to make a new one. So that's out of the question. Now, here's an imaginary solution. Imagine that we had some kind of accountant that could come into the sender's house and pore over his books and make sure that everything is correct, that all of these checks that the sender knows he did were actually done correctly. And then send a digital signature attesting to this fact, and because everybody trusts accountants, the receiver will be happy to accept the 42-bitcoin payment.
What's the witness?
The witness is the fact that this transaction does not appear in the latest Bitcoin ledger. We'll see a more efficient way to do it in a minute.
It is a coin
fee.
Well, it's easy.
Because
it's easy to prove. It's in coin fee, but it's an easy case of coin.
Indeed.
Right.
You know all the already spent coins, and it's an empty statement to say that the new one is not already there. So of course most of us don't let accountants into our houses, and where would we find one? And we want these things to happen in real time, so we need to somehow digitize this. So this thing is already digitized. There's already a procedure that does this checking, and wouldn't it be nice if you could also have this kind of virtual accountant that would run this procedure and somehow convince the receiver that the statement is true? And now you can see where I'm going. We're going to create a cryptographic proof attesting that the statement is correct. More generally, there is some NP decision algorithm for some relation connecting this NP statement to a witness known by the sender, and we want a proof that this NP statement is indeed in the designated NP language.
Here you are trying to hide also the statement that you are trying to prove, because the statement included that you got it from Mr. X. You don't want that to be revealed.
The statement has to be carefully crafted to not say where I got it from. It has to say that there exists someone that I got it from, and actually that transaction there exists in the Bitcoin ledger, but I'm not going to reveal which one. So it is indeed one of the properties we'll need. And let's talk about the properties. So we want it indeed to be a proof, to be a convincing proof. And for efficiency reasons, we'll slightly relax it to be only computationally sound, making it what cryptographers like calling an argument. So we need an argument for an NP statement. We want it to be non-interactive. And that goes back to the question that Alessandro was asked about non-interactivity. In our case, we don't want this protocol to be interactive because that proof is going to be broadcast to everyone in the Bitcoin ledger. We don't want the whole internet to come talking to the poor sender and interact with it to know that his transaction was correct. We want it to be generated once and verified by millions of people out there.
Spent already 7, and now you have to convince that the 3 are still spendable. So it's not that you have to say that you never spent anything, but you have to also do the arithmetic.
That's precisely right, and indeed we will tackle this issue towards the end of the talk. Yeah. An additional property we want is a proof of knowledge. The statement has to be not just true, but also the sender has to know the witness, as is usually the case when the statements involve cryptography. For example, the fact that there exists a signature on a statement is very unconvincing. Of course, there exists. The question is, do I hold that signature? Because only the owner of the private key could generate it efficiently. So we need it to be a proof of knowledge in the usual formal sense, and we want it to be succinct in the sense that proofs are short. They're going to be sent over the internet and broadcast on the distributed network that creates the blockchain. They have to be short, and because everybody's going to verify them, they also have to be efficiently verifiable. And that's exactly the succinctness relation that Alessandro described as well. And so overall, what we get is a snark, conveniently enough. And There's one property I haven't mentioned yet. So far, we were very careful to protect the verifier from receiving false payments. We were careful about efficiency. But so far, I haven't said anything about the privacy of the sender, which is our whole goal to begin with. So let's add zero knowledge to the proof. Nothing about the witness known to the sender will be leaking to the verifier or anyone else through that proof. So we have a ZK snark, and that's the primitive that we need. Now, ZK snarks are useful for many other purposes. You can use them to prove integrity of computation on the cloud. You send some computation to a virtual machine out there. It comes back with the result, and you can check a computation that maybe took many hours, many years in someone's mind, and just look at the short proof and verify it efficiently. That's another potential application for SNARK. You can use SNARKs for potentially for checking the integrity of a hardware that you bought but don't trust, the so-called information technology supply chain issue. That's a big, that's a very big deal when even military hardware deployed in the field turns out to often contain counterfeit components. So there are many motivations for SNARK. I could spend a lot more time talking about this, but by now I hope that we are sufficiently motivated to recall how they can be constructed. Now, pre-processing SNARKs, the ones that that have this key generation process, these are fairly a fairly new object. The theory goes back to 2010, followed by rapid evolution of improvements since then. And there's also really a deluge of works implementing these SNARKs in the last couple of years. I will not have time to describe the content of all of them, but we can see how they're used and what parameters they offer. Let me point out, just connecting to the cloud motivation, one particular work from 2013 crypto. I think this is conceptually interesting. It shows that you can take any C program, send it anywhere. We concretely sent it to Amazon's EC2 cloud, have it run there. And after you compile it with our special compiler, and then a special compiler makes the program not just produce the output, but also a succinct proof that the output was correct. So the big EC2 comes back to you with a short answer and a short, with a short proof, and in a few milliseconds, you can check that result. The issue with these pre-processing SNARKs is indeed that they require trusted generation of keys that are required for proving and verification. It has to be once, it's not too expensive for the case of zero cache, it's not too expensive when you use scalable SNARKs, but it's an issue of trust and in some cases efficiency. The alternative actually greatly precedes that, and that is SNARKs that do not have preprocessing, and they, the known constructions for that are based on PCPs. And we know that in principle it's possible, with the works of on CS proofs of Kilian and Mikali, some extra assumptions are required. We now know that they too have plausible candidates, and we even have some plausible constructions for reasonably efficient PCPs. But that's not the direction we take in this work. It hasn't yet materialized sufficiently well. These remove the trusted setup assumptions, so we hope that they will soon become practical as well and remove that limitation. Now, let me be just a bit marketish here and mention that some of the names here may appear repetitive, and actually many of these works are part of a collaboration between ETH, MIT, Technion, and Tel Aviv University with our respective groups. It's called SkipperLab. It has a URL with a bunch of with a website giving information and source code for these works. We are actively seeking improvements and extensions and applications of these works. So if you're a graduate student looking for exciting things to do, let's talk. Now, Let me just give a feel about the progress here beyond the counting of papers and titles. One way to think about it is focusing on SNARKs for C, non-deterministic programs written for C. And I apologize for the many omissions here. I'm omitting SNARKs for languages that are for classes that are somewhat smaller than NP, like the work of Shafi and many follow-ups. I'm omitting things that don't focus on C, just so I can draw a consistent table here. And you can see the original works of Mikali and Kilian, showing that in principle this can be done for the one-hop case, but yeah, it's polynomial time, it exists. Then it was extended to handling multiple hops, proofs about proofs about proofs, in the spirit of what Alessandro described. Then we actually had working systems that have efficient verification and working, but less efficient proving. And they held on initially small C programs running for little time, then any C programs but still running for a short time. And with the scalable SNARK, we can actually have them run for any time. Efficient proving remains a challenge. So for some applications, like the general case of cloud computing, you wouldn't be using these yet. The overhead is just too big. In our case, it's bearable. Alessandro's talk was about this work and the one we use in Zerocache. The underlying SNARK engine that we use, as you'll see in a minute, uses the implementation from this work. So let's indeed go back to Zerocache and see how it uses these. So I'm going to describe the Zerocache scheme gradually, starting from some naive solutions that are obviously insecure, then fixing security, but still having very rudimentary functionality, and then building up as time allows to show you cool stuff that we can do. That's more than enough to create a proof, but not to explain it. So let's start with the Stroman solution. Here's a stupid way to do Zerocache. Sorry, to do cache. In order to create a coin, you create a serial number, and you say, I'm hereby create this anonymized coin by consuming a Bitcoin and creating a new anonymized coin. So this is just fixing one concrete way to instantiate things as a way to create a new currency by giving it value based on Bitcoin. You simply burn a Bitcoin in order to create an anonymized coin. Let's call this anonymized coin zero coins, just for concreteness. Zero, of course, for zero knowledge. Hopefully not for zero value. So I tell everybody, hey, I'm spending one Bitcoin to create one zero coin, and here's a unique serial number, and all these serial numbers are public. On the right here, we're going to draw the public ledger. And in order to spend the coin, I just say, okay, I'm using the coin with the given serial number. This is obviously insecure in a number of ways. In particular, anyone can see the serial numbers and therefore claim my coin. So let's not do that. A much better way to do it was proposed by Sander and Tashma, and they said, let's use a commitment scheme and some zero-knowledge proofs. So we take a standard commitment scheme with the property that when you run it, you can input two values, in our case a serial number and some commitment randomness. The property that is that once you've revealed the output of the commitment, you're committed to the serial number. You can't find any other randomness that will result in the same output. But the commitment is also hiding in the sense that someone who sees the output has no idea what's your serial number. That looks kind of right. What you can actually do is say, this is going to be the structure of the values associated with the coin. In order to create a coin, I will tell everybody, look, I'm going to spend one Bitcoin to create a commitment, and I publish the value of that commitment value that goes into the public ledger. And then in order to spend the coin, I'll say...
So this is not tied to your account. So that serial number was announced in connection with your old
right.
Bitcoin.
Yeah, and when I say I spend the Bitcoin,
it's traceable back to your old history.
So far it is, but as we'll see, eventually there will be no connection between these commitments that are indeed associated with the Bitcoin account and the eventual spending. So in order to spend, I can say, and fall into Addy's trap, I can say that I'm going to spend a coin. Here's the serial number of the coin. I now reveal it, and everybody makes sure that it hasn't been used before. And here are the corresponding commitments and randomness, so everybody can check that the commitment indeed appears in the ledger and that the serial number and the randomness match that commitment. So that's secure in terms of false spending, but it does allow a connection between the commitment and the original minting of the coin, therefore breaking privacy. In order to fix that, we actually don't reveal all of that information, but instead we go through in a direct way. First, we create a Merkle tree on top of all of these commitments, and then we publish, in order to spend the coin, we publish a zero-knowledge proof saying, I know some coin commitment, but I won't tell you which one. I just prove to you in zero-knowledge that that commitment is in the tree. And I know the corresponding randomness, so you can check that everything is consistent. So the just to make the statement succinct. If I put the whole ledger in the statement, then just writing it down can be too long.
These are all the commitments that are in the system.
Yes. These are all the commitments that are in the system so far. So that actually works. And if you use an efficient non-interactive zero-knowledge proof system, you can actually implement this. It was not done by the original paper of Sundar and Tashma. It was first done by ours, but...
It does reveal some information, because once you try to authenticate a particular node, you know how many levels there are, so it tells you how many bitcoins turned into zero coins.
And in order to address this, you would set the tree depth to be a constant. We set it to a depth of 64, and we assume that there will be less than 2 to the 64 transactions.
Okay, so you feel it is dummy.
Yes, that's good enough. And all of the performance number I give are for depth 64, which is quite sufficient. Okay, so that works, but it's still very limited. Let's just make sure that we have the right kind of proofs in order to verify these statements. We need this to be convincing proofs, so argument. We want them to be non-interactive, so we can just send things and put them in the ledger. We want them to be zero knowledge to break the connection between the use of the commitment and the creation of the commitment during minting. We want it to be proof of knowledge because, hey, it talks about crypto and succinct for efficiency. ZK snark, check. Proving this is somewhat more elaborate. And once we're using ZK-SNARKs, well, they really are for NP statements, meaning that we have a lot more flexibility than what we've exploited so far. We can create various other statements that will give us a lot of additional functionality. Let's see what kind of functionality we get. And the first one is, by request from Adi, handling variable denominations. So far, I describe one Bitcoin converted into one zero coin, but what happens if you want different zero coins with different values? So you can tweak the structure of the values associated with the coin and the conditions that they should fulfill. You would add another commitment scheme. So now we have two levels. The value of the coin, just an integer floating point value designating the value, goes as a value into an outer commitment. And some value k goes into it as well, coming from an inner commitment. The serial number is down on top. We have two commitment randomness. And now we can work out how to actually mint and spend and what to put in the NP statement. In order to mint a new zero coin of a publicly known value, because we created it from some public Bitcoin, we reveal the values V and K and R prime, and everybody can check consistency. And in order to prove this, we need to... make an NP statement about knowing the hidden values and the corresponding V, and publishing the corresponding V. This is for a statement that reveals the value V. Then we can add additional functionality, like letting people pay each other. We can add the notion of addresses or keys where people can create public keys and private keys, and by knowing someone's public key, we can send them a payment, and then in order to do that, we add some additional structure. We make the conditions and the data richer, and then there's some procedure for how to mint and how to spend, and it works out, but time will not suffice to describe the details. And putting these together, we can take all of the functionality and all of the IP statements that we constructed and actually present them in one unified way. It's a very elegant way to think about it. We can have a single type of transaction supported by a single NP statement that does anything you would want. Sending payments, making change like Adi requested, exchanging bitcoins into zero coins and back, drawing transaction pieces, public values to be paid to miners. Everything goes into that box. And it's we call it a pour transaction because it pours currency in some very general ways. It accepts two old zero cash coins, and it creates two new zero cash coins and maybe some public bitcoins. It also gets instructions on how to split the values and where to send them. These are the public addresses of the recipients and how much to release publicly. And then it does the right thing for that. And it also outputs the serial numbers that are revealed for the coins that were used up in order to prevent double spending. It outputs the commitments of the new coins, so everybody can later believe zero knowledge statements about them. And of course, a proof to be put in the ledger saying that the right thing is done. The old coins were valid, and the values of all the old coins equal all the values of the new coins. This proof, the verification of these statements, these are done by our virtual accountant, by the program running under the SNARK. And what's eventually put in the ledger is just these public values. And concretely, this is what a transaction looks like. These are the values that are put in the ledger. You can recognize some of the ones I described, like the root of the current Merkle tree, serial numbers of the old coins, commitment for the new coins, and then a bunch of other things that we didn't go into, like the ciphertext address to the public addresses of those receiving the coins. And last but not least, and not too long, the actual SNARK proof. Overall, less than a kilobyte. This is in all cases, we do reveal the serial number of the spent coins. That's the mechanism to prevent double spending. The trick is that you have no idea which of the past commitments this serial number corresponds to.
But you also publish the commitments. You know which commitment it was. Oh, you don't know where it started?
You don't know which one is being invoked when that old coin is spent. You just know that there is some coin whose commitment is in the ledger, and the serial number that's revealed now matches that coin and has not been used yet.
They know which one. It's like the CM1
for new coins.
What?
For new generated coins, the two commitments.
Oh, the new commitments are not the commitments.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. You burn an old commitment by revealing its serial number, and you create a fresh one. So, of course, it's only secure under the designated assumption, and it's proven under those. There are various...
No, but I'm saying I could vote for something that works on top of Bitcoin, which allows me anonymity or, privacy. But if, your assumption, the crypto doesn't work, then I lose only the privacy. But it doesn't allow me to generate more coins.
So, actually, our failure mode is the opposite. If the assumptions are false, privacy is maintained, but, if knowledge of exponent is false, then... coins can be faked. It's an interesting problem to get the converse trade-off or achieve both. It's an open one. There are various systems way to bound the damage, but let's take that offline. So formally, we define a cryptographic primitive called a decentralized anonymous payment scheme. It has various algorithms that you'd invoke in order to operate the system. The interesting one, or the pool algorithm, that does what I described, and the verified transaction algorithm that checks it. There are various algorithms to set up things and know when you receive the payment and so on. And defining security here is actually a non-trivial exercise, and we need three different properties, which we defined and proved. One is ledger indistinguishability, which shows that nothing is leaked except public information. And even an adversary that can instruct everyone to do transactions of his choice can't learn anything that he shouldn't obviously be entitled to. Of course, money can't be created out of nothing, and no double spending, no faking coins. And transaction non-malleability, a subtle but important property, saying that in that time window when transactions are broadcast but not yet in the ledger, no one can change them to grab the content of the transaction, for example. We've implemented all of these. It's a fairly non-trivial architecture, but it works with numbers in milliseconds and minutes and gigabytes. And actually, we ran it and simulated it on a whole bunch of virtual machines on EC2, basically the whole Bitcoin scale. So seeing if we took the whole Bitcoin and redid the transactions, but this time with zero cash, preserving privacy, everything still works in real time, and there are no traffic jams because of long proving times or anything of the sort. There are many interesting open problems here. I mentioned a few. Let me mention maybe a very intriguing one regarding applications and extensions, and that is, what else can we put in the NP statement? For example, why don't we take the NP statement and say, yes, I know a coin with a value V and a serial number, and I know some randomness, and everything is consistent, and moreover, I paid 10% tax according to the laws appearing to my particular country, and here's my digital signature on my citizen card showing that this is my country, and my name is in escrow with an authorized notary in case you want to run money laundering checks on me, and so on and so on. You can take many policies that appear desirable in the real world and express them as NP statements by tying them to notaries and signatures and algebra. And maybe this is probably the only way that we can get both privacy and control of regulation, preventing criminal activity, and so on. But what will we put there is a fascinating question. There are many other potential applications of SNARKs for Bitcoin. Time will not allow us to mention all of them. But since we've already described the evolution of the blockchain, here is how it evolved over the past 5 years from 0 to 24 gigabytes. And you can see the trend up there. You can take that blockchain and say, you know what, forget about it. I'm paying you. Let me just prove that my payment is good with respect to the current root of the blockchain. You don't need to know anything else. We save 24 gigabytes or so much more. You can compress the blockchain into just the coins that haven't been spent yet and have a proof that that's consistent and many other things. So with this optimistic view of the future, let me conclude and point out that these URLs contain a lot of information that I did not have time to describe. Thank you.